This video is sponsored by Card Kingdom. If you click on the link in the description below, it'll take you to their store and they'll know I sent you there. Hello everyone, I'm Neat Tahone and it is Friday, so that means it's time for another MTG Top 10. This time around, we're looking at the best evasive ability in the entire game, Unblockable. It technically isn't a keyword, and in fact, the way it is worded in the game these days isn't even unblockable. Instead, as we'll see, it is can't be blocked, but it does appear on a lot of cards, and maybe there's a chance that someday they will just go ahead and keyword it. After all, it does appear in just about every set a couple of times. Anyway, creatures who are unblockable represent an unstoppable force of damage, something that can cause players some serious problems. In this video, we're going to talk about the 10 cards in the game that either have unblockable, can gain unblockable, or grant unblockable to other things. In other words, any card with unblockable in its text was legal for this list, provided that the creature is legitimately unblockable. If a creature has an ability that says it can't be blocked except for or can't be blocked by X, I didn't consider those cards to truly be unblockable, since they only are in ideal situations. Every card on this list just straight up can't be interacted with in combat, no matter what the opponent's board looks like. Alright, before we get started, I want to remind everyone how I score cards in these videos. Pro Tour and Mythic Championship Top 8s, as well as Legacy and Vintage Championship Top 8s are worth 2 points, and a Grand Prix Top 8 is worth 1 point. Now, let's get to number 10. At number 10, it is Venser, the Sojourner, a planeswalker who can make all of your creatures unblockable. In addition to having that powerful -1, which can turn a board into lethal out of nowhere, Venser can also raise his loyalty by blinking creatures. This type of effect is nice for abusing into the battlefield abilities, but it's also sort of a sneaky way to protect Venser. It allows you to attack and then uses +2, and when that creature comes back to the battlefield, it will be untapped. He also has a very powerful ultimate that wins most games if you get there. He was only ever played in Standard, where he had some modest success. The interesting thing is, despite only having 6 points, he appeared in 3 different types of decks. He found success in an all-in aggro deck like White Weenie, was played in some versions of a mid-range deck like Cobblade, and had a top 8 at Worlds in 2010 in Blue-White Control. Venser's abilities are useful in enough situations that he can really fit into any kind of deck. Obviously, the unblockable part was used the most frequently in the aggro deck, but it has its uses in many situations. At number 9, I have Key to the City, an artifact that can make creatures unblockable. The key is pretty nice because it combines evasiveness with the ability to loot. It can basically make sure that you're doing damage every turn if that's what you want to be doing, while also helping you improve your card quality. It also helped that Key to the City was in a standard where discarding stuff was extra good. That was because of the two mechanics Delirium and Madness. Both of those meant you could get as much value out of discarding cards as you could from drawing one. The key was played in Rakdos Aggro, Azorius Flash, and Delirium decks during its time in Standard. It is yet to find a home elsewhere, and it seems kind of unlikely that it will, as it's a little bit clunky for non-rotating formats, although, with Pioneer, I guess anything could happen. At number 8 I have Distortion Strike, which is actually exactly tied with Key to the City. Both have 7 points from 7 Grand Prix Top 8s. Distortion Strike is a sorcery that makes a creature unblockable until end of turn, and because of rebound, you end up paying only 1 mana to make this happen twice. That's a pretty great deal, as that 1 mana often ends up netting you a ton of damage. This was especially scary in modern Infect decks, where you really end up only needing to do 10 damage, so using Distortion Strike on your creature with Infect is a very real problem for your opponents. Especially because Infect decks can frequently also pump the creatures in other ways too. Distortion Strike has only ever seen play in modern Infect decks, and those decks have really fallen out of favor in modern recently, but man, it helped players put a lot of poison counters on people between 2013 and 2016. And number 7 is Whirler Rogue, which is our third consecutive card with 7 points. I gave the Rogue the edge over the other two because she has more Pro Tour Top 8s than they do. Whirler Rogue is just a hyper-efficient creature. 4 mana for a 2-2 and 2 1-1 flyers is pretty great, and that alone might just have been enough for her to see some play. But, in addition to all of that, she can also make creatures unblockable by tapping 2 artifacts and, wouldn't you know it, she comes with 2 artifacts. This means that she can immediately add damage to the board by making a creature unblockable the turn she comes down. She found a bit of success in Standard during the time that both she, Insole Artifact, and Shrapnel Blast were all legal there, in a pretty potent artifact deck. This was relatively short-lived, though, and she never really saw play in Standard after those two cards rotated. However, she has seen some more recent play in Modern Human decks, which, as you probably assumed, are Tribal Human decks, and the Rogue just happens to be human, making her a good fit for those decks. She isn't exactly a staple in those decks, but she has managed 3 points in Humans decks in 2019 so far, so she may continue to move up this list going forward. At number 6, it is Miss Cloaked Herald. The cards we've looked at so far have done all kinds of stuff in addition to having something to do with unblockability. Miscloaked Herald is much simpler. All it is a 1-mana 1/1 that can't be blocked. The Herald didn't see much play at first, but by the end of 2018, Mono Blue Aggro decks had emerged as one of Standard's best decks. It was a deck built around difficult to block small blue creatures, with most ideal scenarios involving putting a Curious Obsession on one of them. If you can't deal with a Miscloaked Herald with the Obsession on it quickly, you're probably going to lose. The Obsession not only makes it hit harder, but it also draws them cards, which allows them to find ways to protect the Herald and their other creatures, or to add to the damage clock. Mono Blue Aggro decks were one of the best decks around in 2019, up until rotation took a bunch of the cards away, like the Herald. However, Miscloaked Herald did manage 9 points in the format before the deck got dismantled. At number 5, it is Blighted Agent. When we talked about Distortion Strike, I mentioned how good Unblockable is with Infect, and, well, that's why Blighted Agent is so good, because it doesn't need any help with Unblockable, it's always Unblockable. Infect decks are built around making Infect creatures hit for huge chunks of damage, sometimes just one-shotting people, and since the Agent will never be blocked, it is one of the biggest threats in the entire deck. In addition to finding a lot of success in modern Infect decks, the Agent has also been good enough for legacy versions of Infect, which tend to run Berserk, making a one-turn kill with an Agent even easier. Lately, legacy versions of Infect have been more successful than the modern ones, but even so, the last several years the best legacy Infect decks have done is a couple of top 16s, so the Agent hasn't managed any points since 2016. At number 4, it's Invisible Stalker, a card very similar to Blighted Agent. Both are one generic and a blue for a 1-1 that is unblockable. However, the Stalker is traded in Infect for Hexproof, which is probably better in a wider variety of situations. So, while Blighted Agent might represent some serious inevitability in an Infect deck, it can still be dealt with by removal in most cases. Invisible Stalker? Not so much. Hexproof and Unblockable has to be one of the more powerful ability combinations in the game because it really makes the source of damage inevitable, since you can't even kill it with spot removal. Those two keywords combined really make you feel helpless if you're the one playing against it. It also makes it an excellent place to put auras. Auras can be really risky, because you open yourself up for a 2-for-1 if your opponent can kill your creature. But you don't have that problem here. Hexproof means your opponent can't kill it in response to your aura, and unblockable means that the Stalker is going to be hitting really hard if you're putting auras on it. With all that in mind, it comes as no surprise that the Stalker was featured in a Standard deck called Bant Hexproof, a deck running a bunch of auras and difficult to deal with creatures. Putting something like Rancor on a Stalker was some pretty frightening stuff. It was also played in Delver decks, which were not really all in on the Make the Stalker Big plan, but the deck was loaded up with spells and Rune Chanter's Pike, and the Stalker could certainly win the game after being given one of those. At number 3, it's Thassa, God of the Sea. A god who can make your creatures unblockable. In addition to that, Thassa also improves your draws every turn by scrying, and like all the Theros gods, turns into a big indestructible creature once your loyalty gets high enough. Once Thassa becomes a creature, it can target itself with its own ability, becoming a huge unblockable creature who can't be dealt with in very many ways. Thassa was a key card in Standard Devotion to Blue decks, which were well positioned to make Thassa into a creature very early on in the game. Devotion to Blue was one of the best decks in all of Theros Standard, so she found considerable success just in that one deck. Thassa hasn't seen any play since rotating out of Standard, but she's another card that might find some success in Pioneer going forward. At number 2, it's Creeping Tar Pit, a land that can become an unblockable creature. The Tar Pit is part of an extremely powerful cycle of dual lands from Zendikar, which both fix your mana and are creature lands, a very nice combination. Creature lands tend to be pretty great, because they work like a regular land when you need them to, and then they can become your win condition in the late game, especially if your land can be an unblockable creature. In addition to that, creature lands dodge sorcery speed removal, which includes most board sweepers. This makes them interesting win conditions for control decks, but it also makes them pretty nice against control decks. The Pit has been a multi-format all-star. It just brings so much value to the table that decks across multiple formats feel pretty good about running it. In Standard, there was really no reason not to run it if you were in a blue-black deck, and as a result, it saw a fair bit of play there. Most frequently in blue-black control. In Extended, it was played in Fairy decks. In Modern, it has been featured mostly in control decks like Grixis and Bug Control. It has even seen play in Legacy, where it's played in some versions of Delver. The Tar Pit is the most active card on this list, and it seems likely that it will hold on to its number 2 spot on this list. However, can it ever catch a number 1 card? Which is... Aetherling. Aetherling comes with a slew of activated abilities, one of which is the ability to become unblockable. That pairs really well with its other abilities, especially since it can raise its power. In addition to that, it can dodge removal spells and board sweepers with its first ability. The combination of evasiveness and elusiveness made Aetherling one of the primary win conditions for control decks while it was in block and standard, and that's where it managed to get all of its points. Aetherling is a little clunky to be a win condition in non-rotating formats, though, and as a result, we haven't seen it put up any points in over 5 years. So, the question was, will Creeping Tar Pit ever pass Aetherling? I think the answer is yes, probably in the next year, because Creeping Tar Pit is only 3 points behind. Well, that does it for this MTG Top 10. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like it and share it so that others can enjoy it too. If you want to make sure you catch future MTG Top 10s, don't forget to subscribe. And if you want to catch up on the ones I've already done, you should see the playlist on your screen now. Additionally, if you've been enjoying the content and want to give back to the channel, check out my Patreon. Thanks for watching.